Let me take the privilege to welcome Murad Ilala, an ordinary person with an extraordinary dream. He is an alumni of the Lawrence School, Lovedale, and is a practicing cancer surgeon. Besides being busy saving lives, Dr. Murad was a part of five-member multinational team of peak freaks, training to climb mountains, and he became a rare doctor at 50 who climbed the Mount Everest. Let us hear his amazing, inspirational story. Thank you for coming and welcome.
Good morning, everybody. And thank you for giving me the privilege of... And thank you for giving me this privilege of sharing this unique experience of what it takes to summit Mount Everest. Climbing a mountain is different from other sports. The only opponents that you face are the demons that play in your mind. The only goals that you can score are the limits that you set for yourself, whether it be the summit or anywhere else in between. There are no spectators to cheer you on, and many times it's a lonely battle of you versus your mind versus the elements. So what is the romance? What is the aura associated with summiting Mount Everest? It's not like any other mountain where you go to the base of the mountain and you keep climbing, climbing, climbing until you reach the top. If you try that on Mount Everest, you'll never reach the top, nor will you be able to come down. It takes almost 2 months if you want to successfully summit Mount Everest. And Mount Everest, being at 29,000 feet, it comes within the jet streams. The jet streams are very strong winds that rage across the peaks at about 100 to 200 kilometers an hour. And it's just a few days every season that the jet streams move upwards and northwards towards China. And that's the time you have to make your summit push, reach the summit, and get back down before the winds come back. It is associated with risks, accidents, and deaths are a reality on the mountains. I had no prior experience in summiting any mountains prior to this or mountain climbing. And when I scouted around, initially I wanted to train in India, but I was told I was too old. They said you have to be less than 40 years if you want to come and do the basic and the advanced mountaineering in the mountaineering academies in India. And this Canadian group called Peak Freaks had a different take on this. They said, we do not want younger people. We want older people because hopefully you will take more mature decisions. And that's why they allowed me to come with them. But they said, if you want to climb with us, you have to train with us. So they took us to these 20,000 feet peaks, and everything that we needed to learn about summiting a mountain, we were taught during our climb on these three peaks of 20,000 feet, where they taught us everything regarding rock climbing, ice crossings, crevice crossings, etc. And only after successfully going through this program will they invite you back for a bid at Mount Everest. He is Tim Rippel. He is the Canadian team leader. And here, this red sausage that you see is something called the Gamoff bag. Now, this can be wrapped into something like a laptop bag and carried with us on the mountains. And if anyone on the mountain gets acute mountain sickness, the only treatment for that is rapid descent. Many times that is not possible, so you open this up, inflate it with the leg pump, and put the sick climber into that. It simulates a descent of approximately 5,000 feet and buys you time to get the sick climber off the mountains. I stay in Mumbai. There are no mountains around. So I was getting a little panicky. I mean, how do I train for the mountains? And then I found this high altitude gym. So this gym, this chamber, has all the exercise equipment in it. And 1 hour every day I used to go and train in this. And it simulates an altitude of about 15,000 feet. So I used to go there, train there in this thing, so that before I actually get onto the mountains, I'm already acclimatized to approximately 15,000 feet. I will introduce you to my team one by one. The first member of my team was 26-year-old Sean Mooney. Sean Mooney was a Canadian and an extreme athlete. He is the Canadian chess boxing champion. I had never heard of this game before. Apparently, you box in the ring, and when you're supposed to go to your two quarters to rest, a chessboard is brought into the center of the ring, and you start playing chess for 4 minutes, and then you again start boxing. So the ultimate mental and physical endurance game. In fact, 4 months back, he again became the Canadian chess boxing champion for 2014. The next person in our group was from Australia, Kevin Fairbrother. Kevin Fairbrother, about 3 to 4 years earlier, had successfully summited Mount Everest with oxygen. And this year, he was attempting to summit Mount Everest without oxygen. So far in the world, less than 100 people have done that. Unfortunately, on the last day, when we were a few hundred meters feet below the summit, he got too breathless, he had to put on his oxygen, and it just became his second successful summit on Mount Everest. The youngest of our group was from Ireland, Patrick. Patrick, 24 years old, thin, wiry guy, a vegan by character. Now, we all know a vegan cannot eat meat or meat products, and the Sherpas found it very difficult. What do you feed this person on the mountains? So they used to give him a powder. They used to say, put water, put sugar, mix it, and have this. He kept asking them, what is this, what is this? And towards the end of the trip, they told him, this is called champa, and this is what they feed the bulls and the yaks on the mountains with. Mentally very strong. Once when we were at around 20,000 feet climbing, our team leader on the satellite phone got a message saying that Patrick's elder brother, who was also a mountaineer, had died in an avalanche in the United States. We thought that's the end of his trip, he's going to turn back. But he was very practical about it. He said it's going to take 5 days to get back to where his brother's body was, and by then all the formalities will be over. So he said he will continue climbing in honor of his brother, and he'll do the summit in honor of his brother. The next person in the group was myself, the only Indian, the only doctor in the group, and the last person in our group was a lady. Lee Den Hond was from South Africa, and she was climbing for the HIV children of South Africa. Because of that, we had a lot of media coverage behind us, and we had a film crew come in and film us right up to Everest Base Camp, and once a week we were shown on TV in South Africa, and that's how they got the funds to support a program for HIV children in South Africa. If you want to get into the Sagarmatha region or the Everest region, you have to get in through a place called Lukla. Lukla is this small airport which has a runway of only about 400 meters. It's considered one of the scariest airports in the world because at one end is this huge valley drop, and at the other end where we are filming it from is this big mountain. So the pilot has just one attempt at a proper landing or a proper takeoff. We all come in on this small aircraft, 16 to 20 seater aircraft, and everything that you need for your climb has to come in on these aircraft. Your equipment, your food, everything comes in on these. And it's a very exciting place to just stand and watch these aircraft come in and go, because this runway is open just for a few hours every day when there are no winds, no clouds. So all the aircraft come in together. They have a very quick turnaround time, just about 5 minutes. The passengers inside jump out, the passengers outside jump in, and the plane takes off again and goes away. So it's a very exciting place to just watch these planes come in and take off. Now you can see this plane coming in to land. And on the left corner of the screen, you can see the passengers waiting over there. Those are the passengers waiting to jump in onto the aircraft as soon as it stops. And I shall just run this video. It gets a little interesting. So these are the small aircraft. So if you all don't want to climb Mount Everest, fair enough. At least do this flight in and out of Lukla. It's a very exciting flight to be on. So there another plane has come in to land. Now this one is just coming out to make way for the other plane to go in. And now I'll just show you the takeoff. When this plane takes off, you'll appreciate the slope in the runway. So quite a nerve-wracking flight in and out of Lukla, especially the takeoff and the landing, but a lovely flight in because you're flying low in these valleys with these huge mountains looming on both sides. Yeah, that's the slope in the runway. So once you reach Lukla, which is at about 9,500 feet, it's a totally different world. There are no more roads, there are no more vehicles. And everything that you need for your climb has to go in on the back of these yaks or the Nepali Sherpas. The Sherpas, the porters, are phenomenally strong people. They carry these massive loads and still walk 3 to 4 times faster than you can. Now from Lukla, you need to get to Everest Base Camp. That's about 9,000 feet to 17,000 feet. In your enthusiasm, if you rush in, you're going to fall sick because of acute mountain sickness, and that's the end of your program. So you have to take it very easy and stop at these places and take about a week to get in from Lukla to Everest Base Camp, the dictum being that you will not ascend more than about 1,000 feet in a day so that your body acclimatizes to the high altitude. Some of the visuals along the way, pass a lot of prayer stones, prayer flags, temples, and of course the ubiquitous, the Tibetan prayer wheel. So whenever we see these prayer wheels, keep it on our right, move it in a clockwise direction, and your prayers go up to the heavens. We enter Sagarmatha National Park, and along the way, we come to a place called Dingboshe, where the highest spiritual leader of Nepal, he resides over there, Lama Geshe, and he does a special prayer for us, blessing us for a safe journey onwards on the mountains. This is the one with the green haversack is me, and the one to my right is Lee. And far away, you can see two peaks. One is Mount Everest, the other is Mount Nupse. It looks like a clear blue day, a lovely day to summit Mount Everest. But look at the peaks. You can see a plume of cloud. Those are not cloud. That's actually snow being blown off the mountains. And that shows that the jet streams are raging at the peak. So that's not a day you're going to summit Mount Everest. Before we actually reach Everest Base Camp, we come to a place called Monument Hill. Here, our team leader made us sit down, and he gives us a serious talking to. And he tells us that you're getting into serious business because all these monuments that you see here, these stone piles, they're called chortens. And each one represents a climber who's lost their life while summiting Mount Everest. So he said, death is a reality, and if you want to turn back, this is the time to turn back. We also saw the tomb of Scott Fisher. Many of you would have read the book Into Thin Air. It was about Scott Fisher and his six team members who lost their lives just below the summit, and this was the plaque for Scott Fisher. Then we reach Everest Base Camp. Everest Base Camp is going to be home for us for the next 2 months. And this entire village of tents is an international village, and we are all pitched on a glacier. This entire thing is on a glacier at 17,600 feet. We are ringed by these huge mountains on all sides, and we see or hear at least 3 to 5 avalanches happening every day. That yellow tent in the foreground, that was my tent. And it's a fantastic experience to sleep on a glacier, a really unique experience for people like us from the city. Because I'm sleeping in my tent today over here, I get up in the morning and my tent has shifted somewhere else. I'm sleeping in my tent and it suddenly starts tilting. Once I rushed out of my tent, went to my Sherpa and I said, there's water gushing under my tent. He said, obviously, it's a glacier, go back to sleep. So things that are very unique to us city people, but very common on the glaciers. Temperatures there range from anywhere between minus 30 to plus 20. You have these unique ice formations that suddenly come up in front of your tent and in a few hours, it disappears again. We all know about the ecological damage that's being done on Mount Everest, and the Nepal government has taken this pretty seriously. So this lady is someone called a campsite inspector. So if you want to summit Mount Everest, you have to give something called a garbage deposit to the government. Now the campsite inspector comes in, inspects your camp, and confirms that all the debris, including human waste, your oxygen, all the waste products, everything is taken off the mountains, and only then you are given back that garbage deposit at the end of your summit. This is our dining tent, a very comfortable, warm tent for us because it's going to be home for us for the next 2 months. You can see a lot of high-energy drinks, high-energy foodstuff on the table. You're expected to drink at least 4 to 6 liters of fluids every day to keep yourself well hydrated. And we get fantastic food at Everest Base Camp, including sizzlers, thanks to the Nepali cooks over there. Now, before you actually step onto Mount Everest, a Tibetan monk comes in and does a special puja for you. This puja is seeking permission of the mountains to actually step onto her, and only after this will you start your climb onto Mount Everest. This is Mount Everest on the left, and on the right is Mount Nupse at sunset. And I shall first show you in 3D animation what's the route we take up from Everest Base Camp to the summit, and then I will show you the actual visuals. We start from Everest Base Camp, and the most treacherous part of your climb is from Everest Base Camp to Camp 1, because you have to cross something called the Khumbu Icefall. The Khumbu Icefall are just huge blocks of ice that are actually tumbling down the mountains, and a lot of crevices are there. You have to do a lot of crevice crossings, etc. And it takes about 10 hours to get across the segment. It's a little treacherous segment that keeps changing on a day-to-day basis. So you go up this, get across it, and get to Camp 1. You spend a day in Camp 1, a night in Camp 1, and then you come back down to Base Camp. And then you start your climb again, and you go from Camp 1 to Camp 2. From Camp 1 to Camp 2, it looks a lovely flattish area, a walk in the park, but trust me, it's not so. You're already at 20,000 feet. The oxygen content over there is just 50% of that at sea level. And it's very cold. We always start our climb early morning around 3 a.m., 4 a.m. And as the sun comes up, The sun gets reflected off the snow from all the sides and keeps hitting you, and your temperature starts rising, and you go into the plus. The problem is that the moment the sun goes behind the cloud, it again plummets to minus, and the sweat on your body turns to ice. Now, you can't let that happen because, you know, you'll get sick. So you have to keep removing your layers and keep putting on your layers. And even though it's a little flattish segment from Camp 1 to Camp 2, it's pretty tough getting right into Camp 2. So you get to Camp 2, spend the night there, again come all the way down back to Everest Base Camp. Again start the whole trip and go Camp 1, Camp 2, and this time go towards Camp 3. From Camp 2 to Camp 3 again is a very tough segment because there's a vertical ice face that you have to keep climbing called the Lhotse face. And this you have to keep climbing for about 8 hours to reach Camp 3, or you have to turn back. A lot of people turn back at this segment because, as I said, you're at very high altitude and it's very difficult to walk on this blue ice and keep climbing this for about 8 hours to reach Camp 3. So you reach Camp 3, spend the night there, again come all the way down to Everest Base Camp, and again start the whole process again. This whole thing goes on for a month because you have to acclimatize yourself to the altitude. And then you go to Camp 4. Camp 4 onwards, which is at 26,000 feet, it's called the dead zone. It is not compatible with life, so you put on your oxygen there, and the last day of your climb is going to be a continuous 20 to 24 hours climb. You have to climb throughout the night, reach sometime in the morning on the summit, spend a few minutes there, and again come all the way down to Camp 4 to safety. You cannot stop anywhere along the way because it's too treacherous, it's too dangerous. So the last day is going to be a continuous 24-hour climb for you. This is how it looks like when we start in the early mornings. A very pretty sight with our headlamps, but very, very cold. And this is what it looks like. And this is the Khumbu Icefall. That black spot over there is me, and these are huge blocks of ice. A very pretty sight, but you cannot stop along the way because it's too treacherous. The mountain behind me is called Mount Pumori. It's considered the daughter mountain of Mount Everest. And all the visuals that you see are taken with this head camera. It's called the GoPro camera. And these boots that I'm wearing are called the Everest boots. They are very specialized boots that we have to wear. It costs about 50,000 rupees just for the boots. We also carry something called the spot. The spot is something the size of a cell phone that we put on the backpacks and carry with us. It's a GPS device so that back home family and friends can track us on Google Maps and know exactly on the mountains where I am. So I can't tell my wife I'm climbing Mount Everest and run away to Thailand. She'll catch me immediately. The red button that you see there is called the SOS button. While you're climbing, in case any of you fall sick or have an accident, you press this SOS button and the nearest rescue team towards you will come and try and rescue you. It didn't luckily happen when we were climbing Mount Everest, but on our training climb, one of the ladies behind me, she slipped and fractured her ankle, and this was the exact segment where she'd had her fall. I splinted her leg to the opposite leg and we pressed the SOS button. And within about 1.5 hours, we had this helicopter come in to rescue her. Unfortunately, where we were on a ledge where the helicopter couldn't land. So he told us, radioed in and told us to come down to another segment. We did that and put the injured climber into the helicopter, and she was evacuated to Kathmandu. And the same day, her leg was operated upon. This is continuing, the Khumbu Icefall. See, like this, like I can't say I will just sit down here and appreciate the view, because at any moment that huge block of ice behind me will just collapse onto me. A lot of ladder crossings, a lot of crevice crossings that we need to do. If you notice, there's a small spot over there in the sky, that's a helicopter going for a rescue mission. So anytime you see a helicopter going beyond Everest Base Camp, it is going for a rescue mission. This is another day, the helicopter bringing another rescued climber off the mountains. Can you see the climber? That is the climber there in the ring. The helicopter cannot land on the mountains because of the terrain many times, so they just throw down a rope. You rope in the injured climber onto that, and as a low sling operation, the injured climber is brought down to Everest Base Camp, then put into the helicopter and evacuated to Kathmandu. Again, continuing this Khumbu Icefall, it's also called the popcorn segment. And if you all remember, in April this year, 2014, 16 Sherpas lost their lives in an avalanche. It happened at this exact spot over here, which I'm showing. And because of that, this year in 2014, no one climbed Mount Everest from the Nepal side because the government had closed down the entire climbing season. That is me crossing a crevice, and the person behind me is Mingmar. Mingmar is my personal Sherpa. He's my guardian angel on the mountains, and he's there with me every step, guiding me across all the segments of the mountains. So here, he's looking back at me crossing another crevice, and this is what it is to do a crevice crossing. This is taken from the GoPro camera. So you have these ladders that are just thrown across the crevice, and you have these ropes, and you have to get across it. Sometimes you see the bottom, sometimes you don't see the bottom. It didn't matter, either ways I was scared. And many times, even though you're climbing, you have to get down certain segments before getting up again. And it becomes very frustrating because you know for every sort of foot that you're going down, you have to again climb back that. And every foot that you take over there is very exhausting. But that's the only way to go about it. And you can see my safety line always on the rope. So this is how it is. Even though I'm climbing up, I have to get down many segments. Even getting a grip on these ladders is very difficult. You can see the mitts I'm wearing, the gloves I'm wearing. So it's very difficult to get a good solid grip on this. This is another crevice that we need to cross. So sometimes it's one ladder, sometimes it's two, sometimes it's three ladders, depending upon the width of the crevice. And the segment keeps changing on a day-to-day basis. Today I might get across this, but as I come back, this would have collapsed, so another route is found. And it's the Nepali Sherpa icefall doctors, who are called the icefall doctors. They are the ones who set this route for you, and you just follow them. So as I mentioned, they are the true guardian angels on the mountains, and without them, we cannot do a successful bid at Mount Everest. So here, again, an exciting crevice crossing. Initially, it took me about 10 to 12 hours to get across the segment, but later on, as you do this time and again over the season, you become faster and faster at it. And it becomes, in the end, I was doing it in about 7 to 8 hours across. So you cross the segment, and then you come towards Camp 1. So this is Camp 1 at 19,500 feet. We're supposed to spend the night there and come back down to Everest Base Camp. Now there are no more frills. You carry your own utensils. You carry your own food stuff. And now I was back down to Maggi noodles. The first day, I mean, when we went there, we were supposed to spend the night there, but unfortunately, we got caught in a blizzard. Now, you do not know how long the blizzard is going to last. It lasted for 3 nights, and then when I got up in the morning, it was an absolutely clear day. The problem is you've taken limited supply because you're supposed to spend just a night at Camp 1 and then come back down. But you get this blizzard, howling winds. There's nothing you can do. It's too dangerous to step out of your tent. You're spread-eagled down on the tent trying to keep it down because the winds are threatening to lift it off. You can't speak to the person in the other tent because of the howling winds. They can't hear you. You start boiling water and sort of keep yourself hydrated because you boil the snow, make it into water, and keep drinking that to keep yourself hydrated. And luckily, on the third morning when we got up, it was a clear day, and we could run back down to Everest Base Camp. This is how it looks like in a blizzard. You dare not step out of your tent. We always carry 2 bottles with us, the Nalgene bottle in which we carry our fluids, which we keep drinking with, and of course, the pee bottle, which is the pee bottle. It is too dangerous, as I mentioned, to step out even for a pee at night. So you're supposed to use this bottle, open the zip of your tent a little, empty it out, and keep it ready for the next episode. Unfortunately, I didn't know that, and I used it, but the next time I got up to use it, I had not emptied it, and my pee had frozen, so I could not use it again. So then you go towards Camp 2. And this is Camp 2 at 21,000 feet. Again, a helicopter you can see there in the top left corner. That is because another rescue, someone with frostbite was being rescued. Sunset from Camp 2, and you start walking then towards Camp 3. Now, this is that Lhotse face which I was talking about. And the one in the yellow is me just starting the climb on the Lhotse face. This is the Lhotse face. You can see it's solid blue ice because as the snow falls on it, it gets blown away. And you can see the spikes on my shoes. They are called crampons, and they do not sink into the solid ice. It's like walking on rock. So it's very sort of, you keep slipping on it. So you have to keep kicking, form a small niche, get your grip, then take the next step, then keep kicking, form a niche, take your next step. So you have to keep doing this up this vertical slope for about 8 hours before you can actually reach Camp 3. So it's very tiring. This was our group. You can see some climbers down there. You're going higher. Again, some climbers there. And you go above the clouds, it's above the clouds, and you reach Camp 3. Now, Camp 3, you're going to be 3 people per tent. It's just a ledge that you dig into the side of the mountain. again exposed to the howling winds, to all the elements. You can see the snow swirling around over there. And this is us at Camp 3, which is at 24,000 feet. You can see the climber has removed his socks because, again, you've been climbing for so many hours. So you have little sweat between your toes. And if you don't remove your socks and put on a dry pair of socks, that sweat turns to ice and you get frostbite. So however tired you are, you have to take care of yourself, make sure that you're well hydrated, that you're dry, before you can actually lay down and rest. So this is Camp 3. Now the entire month of April 2013 goes in this up, down, because you're acclimatizing yourself, you're training for yourself. And depending upon where your team is from, ours was from Canada, so we got our weather inputs from Canada. And we told that the summit window, which I mentioned earlier, was between May 18th and May 24th. That means that year, that was the only time you could summit Mount Everest. So our team leader chose May 19th as the summit day, and accordingly, you plan your trip off from base camp towards the summit. This time, your team leader sends you out of base camp to an area where there's a signal. So then you call up home, you tell your family that this is it, you're going for the main summit push, and they'll not hear from you for another week till you get back. And you start going towards the summit. You can see again the plume coming off the summit of Mount Everest. The jet winds are still over there as we are climbing towards the summit. Remember earlier I'd shown you Mount Pumori, that daughter mountain behind me. That one in the center of the clouds there, now that is Mount Pumori, way below me. So you keep climbing towards Camp 4, and this is the climb towards Camp 4. You can see a lovely rainbow there, just as we are reaching Camp 4. Camp 4, called the South Col, is also called the Death Zone. It is at 26,000 feet. Human beings are not supposed to be there. You put on your oxygen. We reached there on May 17th evening. You just put on your oxygen. It is very high. The altitude is very high. The oxygen content over there is now one-third that at sea level. So you cannot sleep over there. Sleeping at altitude is very, very difficult because you get something called a chain stroke type of breathing where you breathe rapidly, then you stop breathing for some time, and then again you get up gasping for air and you start breathing again. So this interrupted breathing and non-breathing is called chain stroke breathing. It's very difficult to sleep continuously over there. And of course, because of the altitude, again, you lose your appetite. So you just sit there with oxygen. The entire May 18th, you don't get out of your tent. You're just breathing in this oxygen and waiting for the main summit push. That is the summit from my tent window. And this is me on Camp 4. We always sleep with oxygen, as I told you. And these are the specialized oxygen cylinders we carry with us, which are very, very light. And on May 18th evening, you finally set up for the main summit push. The person behind me is Mingmar. He's checking my oxygen. And on the last day, you carry only your two oxygen cylinders, your water bottle, and a camera. And then you set out. So we set out in the evening at about 7 o'clock from Camp 4 to the summit. It was very cold, about minus 36 degrees. And we set out, you can see a whole lot of lights because a lot of teams had chosen the same day for the summit. The first person is Mingmar, the person behind that is me, and behind me is Lee, the South African lady. We set out at 7 o'clock. At 7:30, I was exhausted, and I didn't know how I was going to do this. And it was just my teammates that kept sort of goading me on, saying, come on, one foot, just one more foot. And we kept climbing, and at 9 o'clock, to make matters worse, my headlight packed up. My headlight packed up, and I shouted out to the team leader, and I said, I don't have lights. So he said, you either turn back or continue without lights. I was too close to the summit to give up, and thanks to Mingmar and Lee, who kept throwing the light and showing me the way. But you don't need light so much to find out the way, your path. You want the lights more to change your jumar, something called, which you put on the ropes, and you have to unlock it and put it onto the next rope, and for that, you're wearing your gloves, you're wearing your mitts, it becomes very clumsy, and it helps if you have lights. So thanks to Mingmar and Lee, I could continue my climb. The only time we stopped is at about 1 a.m., where you stop, you change your cylinders for a fresh oxygen cylinder, eat an energy bar or so, and then you again continue climbing. So the entire night you're climbing, you're beyond exhaustion, you're just putting one foot in front of the other and climbing. And the only thing that lifts your spirits is the early morning sunrise, because for a change, you're actually seeing the sun rising from below you and coming up into the horizon. It's a fantastic sight to see. Plus, it sort of rejuvenates you that the bulk of your climb is behind you and somewhere ahead is the summit. Look at the clear day that was chosen. A fantastic day was chosen for us. Absolutely clear, hardly any clouds, hardly any winds. It was a perfect day to summit Mount Everest. I'm not ashamed to say that on many segments like this, especially where there was rock, I was literally crawling across it because I was so exhausted. and you have to crawl across the segments and then again stand up at the snow segments and keep climbing. You keep climbing, and we were very fortunate, we saw something called the shadow. This is the shadow, or the pyramid, which is the shadow of Mount Everest on the Nepal Valley. So if you're at the right place at the right time on an early morning in a clear day, you'll see the shadow of Mount Everest like this, like a perfect triangle in the Nepal Valley. You keep climbing, and all this time, you're not seeing the summit. You cannot see the summit, because all this time, you're seeing something called the South Summit. This is the South Summit. That's me coming onto the South Summit over there. And only when you reach the South Summit, that way ahead is Nepal. On the right side is China. That is China's side. So more out of nervousness than anything else, I shouted out to Sherpa and Mingmar, and I said, if I slip, should I slip to the left or should I slip to the right? So he said, fall to the right, fall to the right. I was wondering why he's telling me that. So I asked him, why to the right? May 19th at 9:10 a.m., I actually set foot on the summit of Mount Everest. You don't have time to savor the moment. You just have about 5 to 10 minutes on the summit. You have to remove your oxygen. You have to remove your helmet, your mask, because you have to document that you have reached the summit with your photographs. Otherwise, the Nepal government does not acknowledge this. You have just 5 to 10 minutes there because you have limited oxygen supply. You have to still get down to Camp 4 to safety. The weather changes in a jiffy over there, and it's also playing on your mind that most of the deaths on Mount Everest happen on the way down, not on the way up. And if anyone dies on Mount Everest at the death zone beyond 26,000 feet, the bodies are kept there, they cannot be brought down, and depending upon the weather conditions, sometimes you see those bodies, sometimes you don't see those bodies, and this is me making my way down. You can already see the clouds coming in lower down. I have to get through those clouds to Camp 4. As I said, in a moment, the weather will change on the mountains. So that's me coming down from the summit. And this is a Japanese body that we crossed, who had died about 5 years earlier. Unfortunately, we crossed him. You just say a silent prayer and hurry down through the clouds back to Camp 4. So I reached back Camp 4 at about 6 p.m. the next day, too exhausted to do anything. You just crawl into your tent, wait for early morning, an early morning get up and rush down to Camp 2, and that's where I had my first, again, hot cup of tea after the summit. And the next, stay there on Camp 2, next day, get up early and rush down to Everest Base Camp. And it's only when you reach Everest Base Camp that it hits you that you have successfully summited Mount Everest, and then the celebrations start. Now, when we were at Everest Base Camp, we were again told that told that the weather is changing, so get out as soon as possible, and that is why we got in the helicopter to get us out of Everest Base Camp. Again, a very exciting flight to have. That's me hugging the team leader and getting out from the base camp, getting into the helicopter there. It's a very exciting flight because you're at 18,000 feet and you're flying down, just kissing the tops of the mountains as you come lower and lower and lower along the way right up to Kathmandu. So this is the takeoff from Everest Base Camp. So mixed feelings when I was leaving it. I was successful, but it was really a life-changing experience. And this is takeoff from the base camp. And as I said, you just stay on top of this glacier and you follow the glacier off the mountains and then come lower and lower into the valley. Now, as we are coming down, as I said, we were doing this to get away from the storm that was coming into Everest Base Camp. And this is us flying over the glacier. And as we are coming down,
So
headed straight into the clouds. And the problem is that the pilot has to have a visual, otherwise he has to land. We went straight into the clouds, the pilot could see nothing, and we had to land in a field. We got out of the helicopter in this field, but unfortunately, the The clouds did not lift up for that entire day. So that entire day we slept over there on the night also. It was just the next morning that the clouds lifted up and we could get back to Kathmandu. Okay, anyways, ladies and gentlemen, the important thing is to dream and dream big. And tell your dreams to your friends. And if your friends do not laugh at you, your dream is not big enough. But dream to create reality. Do not dream to escape reality. And find your own summit, whatever it may be. So find your own summit and take that first step. Because when you take that first step and you set foot on the summit, you would not have conquered the mountain, but you would have conquered yourself. Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
Thank you so much for giving us this beautiful sight of Himalayas. I've always known Himalayas is beautiful, but the visuals you showed has been a visual treat to all of us. And yes, this applause is completely worth it.
Thank you.
And now I'd request A.V. George to kindly come to the dais to present the memento to Dr. Lala. I'm sure all the entrepreneurs out here can relate to this journey because it's got all the hardships and sweet memories of success. And congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
you. I really want to explore the Himalayas myself, and I'm so thrilled watching this video. Dr. Lala, there are a lot of questions to you and he would be answering to everybody during the break time. And thank you so, so